together with Dr. Padma Chandrasekhar. Today, I think three topics were posted by Dr. Padma Chandrasekhar. And Dr. Geetanjali is a junior gynecologist, Devraj Manik Chandra Hospital, South Carpet. Please come.
I would just like to brush up the basics about the malarial parasite. Malaria is a disease which is caused by Plasmodium species, and it has got four species: Plasmodium falciparum, ovale, vivax, and the malaria. The incubation period of malarial parasite is around 10 to 15 days. It has got two hosts. One is the female Anopheles mosquito, and another is the human. The most common species in the causing greatest mortality is Plasmodium falciparum, and vivax and ovale causes relapsing malaria. The following slide shows the life cycle of the malarial parasite. The life cycle starts with when the female Anopheles mosquito bites an human, the sporozoids from the salivary glands of the mosquito enter into the bloodstream of the human, and then it enters the liver. In the liver, by series of multiplications in the hepatocyte, the sporozoids are converted into merozoids, and then they are released from the liver. The released merozoids infect the red blood corpuscles. They have great affinity for red cell membrane, which consumes the hemoglobin and alters the red cell membrane, and the infected RBCs stick to small red vessels of the brain, kidney, and others, producing various manifestations of the malarial parasite. This cycle continues for a few times. Then after few cycles of multiplication, the parasite enters into a stage called gametocytes, which are the sexual reproductive forms of the parasite. The gametocytes, and then again when a female Anopheles mosquito bites a human, these gametocytes enter into the salivary glands of the female Anopheles mosquito and develop as oocysts in the gut wall, and develop as sporozoids, and again the cycle continues. A special mention should be made about hypnozoids. In vivax and ovale species, instead of converting into gametocytes, some are converted into hypnozoids, which are dormant forms of malaria. So in vivax and ovale species, can cause relapsing malaria even after 1 year of infection. Malaria is one of the foremost public health problems in India, and India contributes about 70% of the cases of malaria in Southeast Asia, with an incidence of about 2 million cases of malaria reported annually. Approximately 1,000 pregnant women die of malaria every year. In pregnancy, malarial parasites sequestered in the placenta, where the infection is often extremely heavy. Strains of the malarial parasite may be pregnancy specific, selected by the ability to bind to the syncytial trophoblast. The following slide shows the presence of the malarial parasite in the intraglial space. These are the chorionic villi, and these are the red blood corpuscles, and the pigmented ones are the malarial parasites inside the red blood corpuscles. So this is a slide of placental malaria. Malaria is a grave disease which produces many serious consequences in the maternal and fetal side. Maternal complications include fever, which can cause miscarriage and preterm labor, anemia, pulmonary edema, hypoglycemia, jaundice, renal failure, acidosis, shock and coagulopathy. The fetal abnormalities include fetal heart rate abnormalities, especially in labor, producing fetal bradycardia, tachycardia and late decelerations. It can even cause premature delivery and it can compromise the uteroplacental blood flow, leading to low birth weight infants. The most important aspect in malaria is that it is a preventable disease, and since it is a preventable disease, it is the duty of every obstetrician and every clinician to always suspect malaria and treat accordingly. Before diagnosing malaria, we should know what are the measures we should undertake to prevent malaria. I'll be discussing the management of malaria and prevention of malaria in the form of two case scenarios, clinical case scenarios. The first clinical scenario runs like this. Mrs. X, who is a nulliparous woman, 25 years old, presents to her clinic and she is anxious to conceive and she has plans of visiting New Guinea to her cousin. She is worried about contracting malaria. How will you advise her? We know that New Guinea, which is in Oceania, it is a more malarial endemic country than our country. So our advice should start with asking her to postpone her trip of travel to any of the oceanic countries or malarial endemic countries. If she doesn't wish to postpone her trip, then give her the following advice. So the first step always in managing a patient like this is advising her to postpone her trip to malarial endemic countries. Next, this will be a useful formula to educate her about the prevention aspect of malaria. One is the A is the awareness of risk. How will you make her aware of the risk of malaria? B is the how will you give her advice to prevent the bites of the female Anopheles mosquito? And C is the prophylaxis in the form of drugs, what drugs we give. And D is that diagnosis must be prompt. She should be informed that the risk of acquiring malaria depends upon the level of transmission in that area and the level of drug resistance and the degree of prevention. The word prevention means that naturally acquired immunity due to repeated bite of the female Anopheles mosquito. Whether she has planned urban or rural sleepovers and the length of stay there in that country and the time of the year, whether it is rainy or dry. Explain to her that risk of acquiring malaria without taking chemoprophylaxis for a month of stay in Guinea is around 1 in 20. So it is pretty heavy there. In our in India and in Southeast Asia, the risk is about 1 in 500. And in South and Central America, the risk is around 1 in 2,500. Now, we should educate her about the methods of bite prevention. She can use skin repellents containing 50% of diethyltolamide, knocked-out mosquito sprays containing insecticides, insecticide-treated bed nets, full cover clothing, electronically fitted mats, and she should be advised that she needs a 24-hour protection from mosquito bite, because though the Anopheles mosquito bites from dawn to dusk, the more dreaded dengue infection is caused by a day-biting mosquito. Now coming to the chemoprophylaxis part, she should be advised that no prophylaxis is 100% effective. Various drugs are used for chemoprophylaxis. It is same as in non-pregnant people. But the difference here is that the drugs we give depends upon the trimester of pregnancy and the drug resistance. There are two types of chemoprophylaxis. One is the casual prophylaxis, which affects the liver stages of the parasite, and they should be continued for 7 days after leaving a malarious area. And next is the suppressive prophylaxis, which affects the RBC stages of the parasite, and they should be continued for 4 weeks after leaving the malarious area. As we all know, it's a usual dosage for those who are planning to become pregnant. It's a usual prophylaxis is given, but the most important aspect is that the patient should be asked to wait till the drug is excreted from the body. If we use mefloquinine for prophylaxis, she should be asked to wait for 3 months because the excretion of mefloquine from the body takes about 3 months. For doxycycline and proquinil, it is about a week. For atavequinone, it is around 2 weeks. And for chloroquine, it is around 1 to 2 months. However, unplanned conception is not an indication for termination of pregnancy owing to the low degree of teratogenicity. If she agrees to take the drugs, provide her with a prescription for mefloquine at a dose of 250 mg, one tablet weekly in chloroquine resistant areas. If mefloquine is not tolerated or contraindicated, you can provide her with a prescription for atavequinone and proquinil at a dose of 150 mg, one tablet daily. In chloroquine sensitive areas, you can use proquinil and chloroquine at a dose of 100 and 150 mg, two tablets daily plus two tablets weekly. Important point to be noted is that whenever we use proquinil in a woman planning for conception, folic acid supplementation of 5 mg is given because proquinil is a dihydrofolate reductase inhibitor and it increases the neural defects in the fetus. Always we should know the contraindications for mefloquine, and by proper history taking we should rule out these indications, contraindications like depression, neuropsychiatric disorders, epilepsy and hypersensitivity with quinine. Provide with the written information and give her pamphlets for the malaria in pregnancy. Suppose if the same patient comes in her 20th week of pregnancy, what will be the advice that you will give to the patient? The advice is the same, like awareness, all the, we can use the ABCD formula. But the recommended drug for prophylaxis in the second and third trimester of pregnancy is mefloquinone at a dose of 5 mg per kg body weight once a week. It has been shown that in prophylactic doses, mefloquinone does not increase the stillbirth rate. A word about the emergency standby treatment in malaria in pregnant women. We can use chloroquine at a dose of 300 mg, 2 tablets thrice daily for 7 days, along with clindamycin, 150 mg thrice daily for 7 days. If the patient vomits within 30 minutes of administration of the drug, repeat the entire dose, and if she vomits between 30 to 60 minutes, repeat half the dose. The next scenario is that Mrs. B, she is a 22-year-old primary gravida. She is in the 32nd week of her gestation, presents to your clinic with a history of fever with rigors for the past 2 days, cold and cough for the past 2 days, and what will be your management? So whenever we have a patient like this, the differential diagnosis is many, but always we should have in our mind, first step is suspicion. Always suspect malaria. This is especially very important because malaria is a disease which doesn't have specific signs and symptoms, and we can miss the diagnosis of malaria when the leading symptoms are jaundice or respiratory. Take a proper history and examine the patient, and the most common symptoms of malaria include fever, chills, sweats, headache, muscle pain, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, cough and general malaise. We should know that incubation period for non-falciforum malaria, that is ovale and vivax species, it can be occasionally 6 months. Always we should have the differential diagnosis in mind, which includes influenza including H1N1, acute respiratory distress syndrome, encephalitis, HIV meningitis, leptospirosis, hepatitis, dengue, scrub typhus, and so on. And now looking for the signs of malaria such as jaundice, splenomegaly, perspiration, pallor, and respiratory distress. What are the investigations we are going to send for the patient when we suspect malaria? The gold standard investigation for diagnosing malaria in pregnant or non-pregnant are thick and thin blood films. Though we use rapid antigen tests, we should mention that rapid antigen tests use antigen and enzymes of a specific species for detecting malaria. These rapid antigen tests are not reliable in pregnancy, and they can be false positive when we have very low parasitemia, especially in vivax infection. Always in emergency, if we do a rapid antigen test, it should be always be confirmed by thick blood films for malarial parasite. As for results within an hour, other blood tests should include full blood count, because malaria parasite causes severe anemia and blood glucose. Malaria also causes severe hypoglycemia. Do the urea and electrolytes, liver function test, blood culture, urine dipstick test, stool test and chest x-ray, which precautions with fear for fetal shaving, because since she is pregnant, fetal shaving is necessary while taking a chest x-ray, and do an obstetric ultrasound to estimate the gestation of the fetus and condition of the fetus. Now, next, our management depends upon what results we get from the blood film. Suppose the blood film says no evidence of malaria. We should always know that single negative test does not exclude malaria. You should repeat the blood film on the second and third day, and if malaria is unlikely, if three negative films are arrived, then for this patient, finish the chemoprophylaxis, and we can move on to other diagnostic investigations. Suppose if the patient is diagnosed as having malaria, the first step is to counsel the patient about the risks of malaria that it can have on the fetus and the mother. Grade the malaria as severe and less severe falciform infection and non-falciform infection, and we can also have mixed infections along with falciparum, ovale or malaria, all mixed infections, and document it. All patients diagnosed with malaria in pregnancy, irrespective of the severity of the infection, should be hospitalized. Severe falciform malaria can present as impaired consciousness, seizures, hypoglycemia, acute respiratory distress syndrome, pulmonary edema, severe anemia, abnormal bleeding or disseminated intravascular coagulation, shock, renal impairment. And for all these patients, they need an intensive care unit admission. Now, coming to the treatment of severe falciform malaria when they have the signs of severe malaria. Use the drug of choice in pregnancy is IV artesunate at a dose of 2.4 milligrams per kg at 0, 12 and 24 hours and daily thereafter. This is the drug of choice regardless of the gestational age of the fetus. If artesunate is not available, then we can go in for quinine at a dose of 20 milligrams per kg body weight in 5% dextrose over 4 hours, and then with 10 milligrams per kg body weight over 4 hours every 8 hours. Oral drugs are started when the patient is symptomatically well and when they are able to retain the drugs. Now, coming to the treatment of less severe falciform malaria when there are less symptoms and the patient should be hospitalized. The treatment is given in the form of quinine 600 milligrams orally thrice daily, along with clindamycin 450 milligrams orally thrice daily for 7 days. Proguanil with atovaquinone 4 standard tablets daily for 3 days can also be used. Now, coming to non-falciparum malaria, the like ovale and vivax infection, the drug of choice is chloroquine 600 milligrams orally followed by 300 milligrams 6 to 8 hours later, and then 300 milligrams on day 2 and 3. As we have already discussed, the non-falciparum malaria, they are more prone for causing relapsing infections. In non-pregnant women, the most common drug given is the primaquine. But in pregnancy, we cannot use primaquine because it can cause fetal hemolysis in G6PD deficiency. And the G6PD status of the fetus cannot be identified in the fetus. So it is better better to avoid primate weight during pregnancy. So for preventing the drug of choice is chloroquine orally for 300 milligrams weekly until delivery, and postpone the use of primaquine for 3 months after delivery. Now we have treated the patient, and what is the advice you will give her before discharge, and what is the follow-up advice? As we have already seen, after a malarial infection, the patient is more prone for getting anemia. So screen for anemia and treat appropriately with iron preparations. And regarding the follow-up of the fetus is more prone for intrauterine growth retardation. So growth scans are needed for monitoring of the fetus. Inform the woman of the symptoms or relapse of malaria and write a clear plan what to do if the symptoms recur, and she should present to the clinician if she again has the same symptoms of malaria. The next scenario is if the same patient, Mrs. B, comes to your clinic with the same symptoms of fever, the chills and rigor, and on her 37th week of pregnancy. We should commence the anti-malarials immediately according to the species and severity, admit to the ICU, and careful fluid balance, avoid overhydration and hypovolemia, regular blood glucose monitoring, and 4th hourly observations of pulse rate, BP, respiratory rate, and oxygen saturation, urine output, repeat daily the parasite count and full blood count, clotting and urea and electrolytes, and if the patient goes in for shock, suspect treat for gram-negative bacteremia. The points to be noted in labor are that when the patients are more prone for getting preterm labor, so we can give tocolytics and steroids for fetal lung maturation. Another point to be noted in labor is that malarial parasitic infection causes thrombocytopenia, so the patient is more prone for getting postpartum hemorrhage. How should recurrence be treated? Recurrence are treated with atovaquinone, artesunate and progranulin, or the WHO regimen of artesunate 100 mg daily with clindamycin 250 mg thrice daily for 7 days. Now the next scenario is Mrs. A has delivered, and what will be the neonatal management? Drug clears the parasites from the blood earlier than in the placenta. Always when a peripartum malaria is diagnosed in the mother, it is an indication for histopathological examination of the placenta and clot blood films to be sent for malarial detection. If positive, screen the neonate with thick and thin blood films at birth and weekly films for the first 28 days and inform the pediatrician. This is the photograph of a neonate hand affected with congenital malaria. So to summarize, malaria is a preventable disease and it is a medical emergency. Suspicion is a key for detection as there are no specific signs and symptoms. Protect mother and fetus by protocol management and send the placenta for histopathology examination and cord blood for malaria detection in peripartum malaria. Thank you.
Any questions? If there is no question, thank you very much.
பத்மாச்சார சார் தேங்க் பண்றேன். ஆசிஓ ஜெயில எல்லாம் நெட்ல காமிச்சாங்க, நேற்று படித்தேன், அதை பற்றி பேசுறேன். பப்ளிக் சென்டர்ல மார்னிங் ஜெனரல் மெடிக்கல் பிசிஷியன் இல்ல, என்ன ரவுண்ட்ஸ் பண்ணிட்டாங்க, நல்ல ரவுண்ட்ஸ் பண்ணேன். ஜெனரல் மெடிக்கல் சைடில் 21 கேஸ், அதில் 7 கேஸ் மலேரியா. 7 கேஸ் மலேரியால ப்ரோட்டோகால் கொடுத்தாங்க, 4 மாத்திரை, 4 2 மாத்திரை, 1 கால 2 மாத்திரை, 3 கால 2 மாத்திரை. 7 பேரில் 5 பேர் வாமிட் பண்ணிட்டான். மாத்திரையே பார்த்தேன் டேபிளில் பை சைடு திருப்பி என்ன சொல்கிறேன், குளோரோக்கின்னு 4 மாத்திரை கொடுக்காதே, நம்ம சவுத் இந்தியன் பேஷண்ட் வயது தாங்காது, வாந்தி எடுத்துருவான். கிவ் பிடி, 1 பிடி ஃபார் 5 டேஸ். இது எல்லாரும் நேர்த்து பேசுகிறாங்க, நானும் கத்துட்டு இருக்கேன், உறவு இல்லை. இன்ஸ்பெக்ட் பண்ண நர்ஸ் ஒன்று சொன்ன நர்ஸ் நான் ஒன் பீட்டு தான் போடுறேன்னா நீ ஏன் நாலு மாத்திரை சாப்பிட்டேன்னா உட்காந்து சார் மூணு மாத்திரை விட வந்து சார் ப்ரோட்டோக்கால் ஒன்று நம்ம பெட் சைட் பண்ணுறது ஒன்று தயவு பண்ணி கொஞ்சம் ப்ரோட்டோக்கால் தான் ஸ்லோவாக போங்க ஸ்ட்ராங்காக போகணும்.